selection for the SAS is cloaked in secrecy.
No one knows what it is we do.
We're the thinking soldier.
And the truth about what it takes might surprise you. An elite team of ex-Special Forces soldiers is putting 30 civilians through the key stages of selection.
At the end of the day, would I have this guy next to me in a war zone?
What?
Each task taken from the real process.
Let's get the dogs out!
Physical fitness is no more than a starting point.
Got my shoulder and quite easy.
The true test is of the mind.
I fear inadequacy.
The only thing that I'm really afraid of is rejection.
I don't really believe that there's such a thing as a completely weak person or a completely strong person.
As each recruit is stripped back to their core.
There might be strong characters.
Fully submerged, Xander!
Once we start unchipping their armor, we'll find out exactly who they are.
Feel like a boy in a man's world.
No other test asks as much.
Well done.
Or means as much.
Still alive!
To the few who make it through.
I know this works. Show me that this works. In the Special Forces world, the bond that we have is sort of a brotherhood. We've all been through the same selection process. We've also been to the same conflict zones and we fought side by side. My life is in someone else's hands and someone else's life is in my hands. Just having them by your side, stacking up against the door, ready to go in, just having one of the guys squeeze your shoulder, you know, knowing that they're there behind you. It just calms all your nerves. It forms something that you would never experience with anyone else. It forms a bond that is unbreakable.
Seven recruits are left on the selection course. For the last 5 days, they've been tested to see if any of them have the characteristics of a Special Forces operator.
I'm fucking dying. Yeah. I'm scared, man.
They're pushing us to the max, all right?
Just keep going again.
You just have to fucking take it.
But you know what that means, is pain.
Just fucking, yeah, torture. Just takes such bravery to go on, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's a good effort.
In just a few hours, Chief Instructor Ant and his directing staff will decide which recruits they'll take with them to the last two stages. A grueling 72 hours being hunted day and night in the mountains before being subjected to the most notorious part of selection, interrogation. Just 6 recruits will be selected to work in 2 teams. Before making their decision, the DS discuss who might have the strength of character they're looking for.
Okay, guys, now we need to make a decision on who we bring forward.
It's the ultimate answer that we always ask at the end of selection. Mm-hmm. Which one would you rather have in your team?
Let's start with 27.
Anthony Selwyn is a professional dancer.
He's sort of half broken, but he seems to be pushing through the pain.
I thought he was gone yesterday, doing the confidence test. And he just shocked me that he then just focused, took a hold of himself, and just went for it.
don't know if he's got the physical robustness to get through the next 72 hours.
When it comes to anything that's a challenge, I will always give it my absolute all. And I've surprised people in the past.
Number 8.
John Calloway is a trainee stuntman. At the start of the course, he stood out for his bad attitude.
Come to the side here. What? Why are you fucking tutting? Why are you tutting?
I want a normal answer without attitude.
It's been pleasing to see him progress a little bit. I've seen him mature exponentially from the start of the course. Attitude-wise, he's come the furthest from where he first came in the door.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think that he's come on this course with a bit of a laugh and a joke, and now he's seen how tough and hard it is. He's taken on as a positive challenge.
Cole, number 26.
Mick is a comedian and reformed alcoholic.
He is, by a country mile for me, the weakest member of the course.
He turned up yesterday for his interview with me and Cole. Took his hood off and it looked like he'd been a fucking JCB ran over his head. I was like, what the fuck have you done to your head?
If I manage to get through the 8 days, then I think I'll have an inner peace. Well, I hope.
23.
Calvin is 19 and the youngest on the course.
He is one person out the whole course that has had some military training. And there's people that haven't that are shining well above him.
Is that the best you have?
Mentally, he hasn't got the ability to go beyond that break point.
For someone to pass selection, you need to really have a character that is reliable. When you're tired, when you're cold and wet, that isn't going to give up on you at the lowest ebb.
There are two recruits the DS feel they don't know well enough to judge. Martial arts fighter Ryan and landscape gardener Freddie.
Right, let's see if we can notice him straight away.
They do some digging on the backgrounds of both.
Whoa. Whack.
And bring them in for tactical questioning.
Recruit two.
Something here that I want you to explain to me. Can you read out that line to me, please?
M16, blah, blah, blah.
This one here.
Ha ha, I was so stoned.
How do you think drugs affects your capability of writing?
Well, I think it affects your judgment with everything. So, yeah, weapons more so because of this.
Guard!
We're looking for a real mental robustness. We want an attitude that's good, determined, willing, obviously, but being able to show initiative, have that humility, and you should be a group of leaders as opposed to a group of followers as such.
I didn't notice you at first. I can see by your ears that you're a fighter. Is that where you get your discipline from?
I wouldn't say so, Steph.
Do you think you've got it from your upbringing?
Yes, Steph.
Just talk to me how you were brought up. What was your upbringing like?
I would say a normal upbringing. Single parent.
Mum, dad?
Family, mum.
How many family brothers have you got?
My brother's stuff.
Sisters?
Two half-sisters stuff.
Everyone says you're quiet. Everyone.
I'm not very, I'm not the first person to speak when I meet a new group of people, and that's probably why he didn't notice me stuff at the start.
You've got to come out of your shell. You need to fucking open up. You need to open up on a confidence front. You need to open up on a leadership front.
Understood, sir.
God.
Before the DS make their call, they have one further trick up their sleeve.
How'd you find that time, mate?
One recruit has avoided any questioning. Number 15, Ross.
I was eyeing it up and I was like, it's just about doable, but it's fucking dangerous.
Ross isn't what he seems.
I passed the Royal Marine Commando training at 17. I got loaded onto my sniper course at 18. I've become one of the youngest snipers in the history of the Royal Marines. I served for 8 years. I did tours in Afghanistan.
For 5 days, he's trained and lived alongside the men. But he was put there by the directing staff to be their man on the inside. A mole. And now, they've a job for him.
What we want you to do, mate, is when I say, does anyone want a volunteer to draw themselves on this course? What you see is just go, you know what I mean? Just boom. Hopefully, I have that domino effect.
I'll try and get in the front row and I'll just fucking hesitate and just fuck it, bang. Just go. Yeah.
At this morning's call, the DS want him to quit to see what effect it will have on the other recruits.
The mole is a fit guy, so to see someone like that break, that can definitely plant a seed of doubt amongst a group. And it's a case of, well, if this guy can't put up with it, but he's been doing so well on the course, then I'm not going to be able to do it.
Everyone in the assembly area?
Decision time. Myself and the team. We've come up with the final members that we want to take forward on the final stage of this course. And it's only going to get harder physically and mentally from here. So if you're struggling, you know who you are. Now is the time to step forward and give me your numbers. Any members of the course here who want to voluntarily withdraw themselves, do it now.
As planned, first to go is Ross, the mole. Second, physicist Matthew Hamer.
You're going to do something then? Did you step forward there?
I began to stuff.
Pardon?
I began to
stuff. Finish off what you're doing.
Third, comedian Mick Dwyer. With three voluntary withdrawals, the DS are not finished. Two more must go.
the numbers that I call out. You will step forward. You will hand your armbands to the DS. And that will be you off the course. Is that understood?
Yes, sir.
Number 23.
19-year-old Calvin is next to go.
Number 16.
Builder Dan Reynolds.
Thank you for fixing us.
Follows.
I'm gutted, man.
I've about given everything I got. And if I had have gone on, fine, I'll go on, but, mate.
The remainder of you will be through to the final stage of this course. Is that understood?
Yes, stuff.
Away you go.
Still alive! Do I want to be alive?
For the surviving six recruits, the final stage of the selection course is in sight.
Escape and Evasion is designed to simulate being left behind on the battlefield. Mission might have gone wrong, might have had a helicopter crash, a scenario where you're being hunted by the enemy. Well, it was the hardest part of selection for me. It really tested me. This is where I really thought to myself, do I want to be here?
If any survive the next 3 days, they will have made it to the end of the selection course. All of the recruits are carrying injuries.
Can't believe how swollen that is. That's disgusting.
Yeah.
But Freddie's condition is worrying the medics.
The guy that I'm really concerned about, Freddie, he came in and his main problem was he had a huge swelling of one of his ankles. It's starting to become quite infected.
It's tracked around his ankle and he's now got cellulitis.
A bacterial infection has breached Freddie's skin, which if untreated, could cause fatal blood poisoning.
So we have to pull him.
He needs IV.
He needs IV, yeah.
Oh, we pull him, simple.
Do you want to tell him?
Yeah, bring him in there.
You want to tell him?
Yeah.
Okay. Ready?
Yes.
Can you come with me and see the doc, please, mate?
It's fine. Don't worry about it.
Come in and see the doc, please.
Chief Instructor.
Sit down. Due to your feet and to the doctor's recommendations, we can't let you go.
This is fine. It's absolutely fine, Chief. It's fine. Absolutely fine. I can fucking jog on the spot. Bit of ibuprofen is really sorted out, I promise to God.
Listen, it's not my call. It's not my call. I'm not a doctor.
Can't stress you enough. It's bollocks. It's absolute bollocks, mate. It really is.
Don't call me, mate, please.
Staff, I'm sorry. It is fine. Absolutely fine.
Basically, the physiology...
All right, it's cool. You're not going to... I can't do it.
Sit down.
I don't want to hear it, though. It's
bollocks, isn't it? Don't have an attitude. Don't have an attitude. Listen, you've got this far. Don't have an attitude with me. Is that understood?
Yes, staff.
A lot of people do come off because of injury. It's out of your control. There's nothing you can do about it.
We need to get you to hospital as soon as possible. Get that sorted out.
It's absolutely crucial that you take care of your body. When you're in a battlefield, are we going to be looking after you 24/7? We're going to have to run up behind you. That's not what we're looking for. Looking for someone who can look after themselves.
Freddie's time on the course is over.
All right, good luck.
Thank you, boss.
Take care.
With Freddy gone, Chief Instructor Ant wants the recruits to be sure they're prepared for what's next.
This is going to be mentally challenging.
Mm-hmm.
I hope
that
doesn't get to you. Get your mental state up with your physical state.
Yes, Dov.
We will pick away at it.
Yes, Dov.
I think I'm fit enough. I definitely think I'm fit enough. But I've always had this thing in the back of my mind about being a failure, and I don't ever want to put myself in a position where I could fail.
Next 3 days is going to be fucking hard.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? We've seen qualities in you. This is why you're sitting here. Because we believe you have what it takes to get to the end of this course.
I've definitely struggled with self-doubt. Definitely. I'm my own worst enemy, and I think most people are. And if I pass on this election, then it's just, like, it's proof. Categorically, you are strong.
Ready, guys?
Let's go.
The five remaining recruits are driven deep into the mountains to their drop-off point.
There will be a hunter force which is out looking for you. The longer you can evade capture, the less time you will spend in captivity and therefore in interrogation.
Start taking in the ground around you, guys. Look out the windows. We're getting close now to the drop-off point.
They will need to head west through a series of three rendezvous points in order to complete their mission. They've been divided into two units. Alpha Team, Freddy and John.
I believe the Woodland Point should be our first attack point, which is situated just over there.
And Bravo, Ollie, Anthony and Ryan.
Ollie first, yeah, me middle, yeah. Keep down.
Each team is followed by an embedded cameraman. Ahead of them is 30 kilometers of wild terrain, which they must cross at night to hit their first RV in 9 hours. Between them and RV1 is a hunter force. The recruits believe they're out to physically capture them. But in reality, they're being deployed by the DS to force the teams off course and see how they react.
If we drop the hunter force down there, then they'll go up and they'll go up.
Ten minutes past 11, boys. Good time.
We basically should just hit down to the bottom of this.
Yeah, aim for the river.
And then just basically go down to the right side, so just off peak, because we don't want to be this side.
3 kilometers away is Bravo Team, Ryan, Ollie, and Anthony.
It'd be cute if we can get to the forest.
Yeah, so we just keep powering on, all right, boys?
Yeah, let's go.
They decide to take a direct route to RV1, sticking to high ground, but staying below the ridgeline. The DS have already tracked down Bravo Team's location.
This hunter four,
hunter
group is very, very close now.
Yeah.
These guys are out now, almost 6K, so they're getting very, very close together now.
Hunted is a horrible experience.
We've got to hurry up, Ryan.
You know, you're deep behind enemy lines. You've got a hunter force of God knows how many. You don't know what's after you. You don't know what they're going to do to you. And it's always plants that seed of doubt as well. If I get captured, what's going to happen to me? So it's being able to compose yourself under immense pressure.
Ah, fuck.
You okay?
Yeah.
Give me a hand.
To evade the Hunter Force, Bravo team is forced down the mountain and 4 kilometers off course. The DS have told the recruits to avoid roads at all costs.
Traffic control, this is Ollie.
And plan to ambush them if they use them.
Okay, run to the bottom, then walk up top.
Yeah, once we get up, we'll have a quick drink. Yeah.
With 6 kilometers between them and RV1, Freddie and John pick a route, which forces them to cross a road.
It's quite a slope here. What the fuck is this? What, is this a road?
Okay, guys, they've crossed the road. Stand by.
Come on, you little weasels, where are you?
No, be like that, wow. It's fucking cold, mate. Shit, get down. Stay down low. Shit. We need to fucking... If they get out, mate, we're going to have to bolt across this. Stay down, don't move.
Stand on the high ground.
Let's get the dogs out!
Downhill.
There has been a few occasions where I've been operating behind enemy lines. And it's quite a nerve-wracking experience knowing that there's enemy forces out there in front of you trying to cut you off. You know, you've got a lot of people that you've just pissed off. We've literally, like, poked the hornet's nest and they sort of come out. They want revenge for what we've just done.
Eight hours ago, Bravo team, Ryan, Ollie and Anthony, were forced off course by the Hunter Force.
Yeah, let's go.
They've struggled to get back on track, and it's beginning to take its toll on 24-year-old dancer, Anthony.
Andy, are you right, man? I haven't heard from you in ages.
What?
I haven't, like, heard anything.
Yeah, I can't, like... Keep my eyes open, basically.
Just basically, right, we just need you to just stick with us.
Yeah, I'm doing my absolute.
That's all, yeah, I know you are. We're almost there, right?
So one more second. I can't actually just keep my eyes open.
Just sit down, right?
Just take it
up, please. Take a seat.
No, I'm just not going to get back up if I go down.
Ollie, okay. Stop. We need to give him.
No, don't give it to me. What I'm going to do is ask at the checkpoint if I can hand in my banner and you can just go on without me and say...
We're a team, right? There's a reason you're here, right?
Yeah, but I don't know. I think I'm
out. Just listen to me, man.
Behind enemy lines, in hostile environments, uncomfortable situations. At one point or another, someone will hit that wall and then the others should rally round and get round that guy and help him out because, you know... A couple of days later, it could be someone else. Someone else that was there as a support could be the person that needs support. Predominantly, you're there for the guy that stood either side of you. That's what it's all about.
Badge. I'm genuinely thinking...
Genuinely, don't hand in your badge. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Come this far, eh?
Mate.
It's all right. We're a team, man, right? This is all it is.
Yeah. But
what?
I feel like I'm going to collapse.
You won't collapse. Get on my shoulder and carry in.
No.
That's what's gonna happen if you collapse.
I would like to think that I could forgo my own ego to get something done. So if that required me to be a leader, I would do that. If it required me to be the organizer, I would do that. Finding out what makes them tick or what makes them work, and then using that to the greater, the team's advantage.
once you guys start setting off at that pace again, I'm just gonna, I feel like I'm gonna start feeling like I'm gonna collapse again. I've reached the point where I just wanna go home.
But you're giving up mentally before your body's actually physically ready to go. Does that make sense?
No. Because it's the opposite.
But we still walked. We still walked up this hill and walked down it again. We're doing it. But, you know, we're not falling over.
Mm.
Nobody wants to be weak. People don't want to be scared. Water's all you really need, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Stay hydrated. So I grew up with my mother in Belfast. In the early 90s in Northern Ireland, or Ireland, whatever you want to call it, it was obviously a situation where there's a lot of tension. I came from a Catholic background, living in a Protestant area.
All right, next RV point, boys.
Okay. One of my earliest memories is actually having a fight. Just remember being physically challenged, you know, like, everybody gets picked on, I guess, at some point in their life. And then I guess that kind of set me off, I guess, from a young age. And the more I think about it, the more I think that's maybe why I'm driven towards doing the things I do now. It's just the idea that I didn't have any older brothers or anything like that to sort of defend you, so you felt like you had to be physically able to defend yourself.
Team Alpha, Freddie and John, have been on the run all night with no sleep.
This is the valley.
That's where we're on right now.
This is the valley. We just need to be on it somewhere.
Shit.
We're just completely lost now.
They've managed to evade the hunter force, but are now lost.
Is it possible that we have gone completely, like, literally, like, we're 5 kilometres away?
There's times during escape and evasion where if you're close to breaking, if you have a slight injury, if you have any mental doubts, you'll be found out.
We're gonna fucking get run over.
Mate, we're not gonna get run over. We're just gonna plow through, and we know where we are now.
Fucking good luck. I'm fucking pissed off.
This is all essential, muddling through. Mate, we've been marching for 12 hours. You've got to give us a little bit of credit for that.
Fuck off. Get no credit for
12
that,
12 hours, with basically no
we've
rations.
We've been lost for fucking hours.
When the going gets tough, it's just about keeping all the positives you can.
Mate, we're dead in 2 hours.
We're not dead in 2 hours.
There we are.
Got enough water. Let's go.
Oh, my feet.
Mate, come on, let's go. Suck it up.
I went to university at Cambridge. It's a pretty highly pressured place, for sure. There were loads of times which are sort of highly stressful, but I didn't let the exam pressure get to me too much. It's just tick something off your list, and then just keep trying to tick things off your list. And it's not about whether you complete it or not, it's your attitude with attempting to complete it.
So they've come in westwards towards us.
The Hunter Force track Bravo team, Ryan, Ollie and Anthony, to the foot of a valley.
But that isn't on the map.
They've been on the run now for 16 hours.
All right. Come on, you all right?
Mm-hmm.
Land.
Oh, I know it's hard, man.
It's fine. Thanks.
Let's go.
There's two people over there.
Fuck.
Anton. Here you go. Here you go.
And come on, man.
Back. I like to think I won't quit. I like to think anything you throw at me, I won't quit.
even if you're hurting, you've got to put a brave face on all the time, I think. I grew up with my stepfather and my mum. We've got quite a complicated family, and then my two brothers.
And there's the junction. Let's go down there.
My mum, she had cancer when I was about 8 or 9, I think. Probably the worst memory I have is when she had to sit me and my middle brother down and tell me, you know, that she's gonna die. And, you know, I just want to just... It's just, something you shouldn't have to hear. I remember, you know, after it happened and just walking around the house and, you know, all that was left was a house full of men, you know, my stepdad and my brothers. And I remember just feeling like, you know, we can't cry about this. We can't really talk about this. We're just gonna, you know, suck it up and be men about it, as, you know, which is stupid in hindsight, but that's the way it was. So it meant that, you know, I had to brave it on my own, really. And it meant I just, yeah, had to grow up, really.
Hours into the escape and evasion phase, and with the recruits still out on the run, a team of interrogators arrive at base to prepare for their capture.
Once you come off the escape and evasion, you go straight into the interrogation phase. You get complete shock of capture, and that's when your mind starts to play games on you.
Coming from a civilian background, these guys have got no idea what the interrogation holds.
We're gonna die soon, mate. We've got no food.
Having been thrown 8 kilometers off course, Freddie and John are still heading in the wrong direction. Straight into the path of the DS.
How the fuck can they get it so wrong? Down on your knees, face that.
Where the fuck have you lot been?
If you're captured before the allotted time at the end of that phase, you would go in the bag.
Do you want to fucking pull off this course?
I do need to concentrate and really focus, and that's when it counts, really. That's when we get to see whether they're actually people that can operate in really uncomfortable situations when they're tired, run down. I would guarantee nearly all of these recruits will be questioning why they are on this course, whether they really want to be there.
Mate, I'm fucking quitting. You'll have to do this on your own. What are you doing?
Staying in.
Do you want to fucking pull off this course now?
I'm going on.
So you want to come off the course?
Yeah.
Okay. Give me your armband. Get the fucking.
I haven't got an armband. It's lost.
All right. We'll get in the vehicle.
I don't like to be disrespected. I'm proud. Everyone has anger issues. I'm not angry at an individual or something. I'm just angry at me not being enough.
Before he's allowed to walk off the course, John is sent to speak to the chief instructor.
You've obviously been bagged and tagged, and they obviously got to your head, mate.
That fucking mishap earlier, I was fucking tired.
Fucking hell, John.
fought your corner. Foxy's fought your corner. A lot. Is this really what you want? Do you want to go home? That's what I'm saying to you. Right now, if you had a choice of getting back out there or going home, what would you do? Would you want to get back out there? Or is this the end of the road for you?
I still want to go back out there.
You would want to go back out there?
Your staff.
Get your kit. You've got 5 minutes. Get your kit back on. Look around you. Use this time to sort your head out.
Staff.
Freddie and John are taken to RV2, where they are joined by Ryan, Anthony and Ollie.
OK, guys, so you know the coordinates. Two extra guys on your patrol now.
These two fences, get straight into that field as fast as possible. Make sure the roads are clear before we do it. And when we're in there, we're going to move across, out past these buildings. Everybody clear?
Yep.
Let's crack on.
I'm okay. I was having a tough time last night, but I sort of got a new lease of life. Yeah, I think it was like sleep debt plus lack of any sort of nutrition in my body.
Some of the situations you find yourself in within the Special Forces are quite intense.
I need to get back on path, really.
You see who's there with you, stood shoulder to shoulder, and that, you know, it does, it creates a bond.
Thanks,
John.
Thanks.
Thank you, John.
Fuck.
Hold my hand.
It doesn't matter where each of you is from, you know, that doesn't matter. It's what you've been through at that moment in time that brings you together.
I know I'm determined. I know I'm really fucking stubborn. So if you tell me I can't do something, then that'll probably make me want to do it more.
Mate.
Best outcome here is that I complete it and, you know, I do myself proud.
Oh, they're cooking food.
They've covered 20 kilometers of wild terrain and been on the run for nearly 24 hours, but they've reached their final RV.
Guys, it's falling.
I'll just give you a quick brief on how we're going to load up.
So, if you take your kit off first.
I haven't slept in 48 hours.
Oh, my back is in bits, man.
Almost there, mate.
Oh. So, for those you three there, if you just pile into the actual back seats here. And then Ollie and John, if you pile into the back.
Oh, there's tea and biscuits in here.
Oh, my God.
Yep.
Yeah. Oh, there's white tea in this one. You want white tea?
Thank you.
Once you've been picked up at the final checkpoint and you've got that cup of tea and that biscuit, you'll be surprised how quickly you switch off and how quickly you become relaxed and you think, right, this is it, you know, we're going back to safety now or we're going home.
Anybody have any ideas where we are at all?
Thanks, John. Well, we just passed. Said there was a camping site on the left hand side, about a mile, about 400.
The ambush will replicate the shock of capture. Smashed, they're ambushed and brought back down, crashing to Earth.
Get down!
Now they're under capture, their adrenaline's going again, and it starts all over again.
Been drained mentally, physically. Your mind's not with it anyway. And you know they're just gonna put you through a whole world of pain.
Next time.
I was in Iraq, captured, blindfolded, beaten.
I may have been special forces, but I want to be alive.
Who map read? You did. Who planned it? You did.
I understand this looks really bad.
He's the one that will fall for the old charm.
I can either be good mummy or bad mummy.
That is this phase complete.
You have passed the course. Well done.
Jessica Chastain stars in Catherine Bigelow's fact-based drama Zero Dark Thirty this Wednesday at 9 over on Film 4. Next here tonight, hostilities escalate between the Gerhardts and the Kansas City crew in Fargo.